I'm really happy to have Melanie Driscoll here. Melanie Driscoll came here from Baton Rouge, Louisiana. Melanie is the chief scientist down along the Audubon Gulf Coast. She's very involved in coastal stewardship efforts, establishing programs along the Gulf Coast, as well as the Mississippi Flyway up into the Great Lakes region. And she was very intimately involved in the Deepwater Horizon situation. So please welcome Melanie Driscoll.
Thank you very much. Thank you for coming. And I will thank you in advance for your patience. This is a long talk. So hopefully it'll be interesting. So this is sort of a three-part talk. I'm not going to do a lot of transition between. It should be pretty obvious. Ironically, in the worst irony possible, on Earth Day of 2010, the Macondo well exploded about 70 miles out and a mile deep in the Gulf of Mexico, killing 11 rig workers and upending the lives of everyone else who was involved on that rig. It took 87 days to stop the flow, and in that spill, over 4.9 million barrels of oil, or 168 million gallons, were spilled. There's an estimate. I'll talk about the details between the official estimate and another estimate, but our belief in Audubon is that about 1 million birds were killed in that disaster. The birds really became the icons of the spill. Despite the fact that there was human life lost early on, it was pictures like these that captivated the nation. The eyes of creatures mired in oil and struggling to survive hurt people's hearts across the U.S. And in the first couple of weeks of the spill, I did a couple of news interviews, and everybody called me on my cell phone because Audubon is supposed to fix everything for birds. I know folks out here are really familiar with, as many people are, the Exxon Valdez. And so in this tale of two disasters, I'll point to a couple of comparisons just for perspective. The Exxon Valdez showed a fairly big footprint, but the Deepwater Horizon, again, exploded way a lot further out in the Gulf. The spill lasted for a long time, and it was not exactly a finite source of oil, so it just kept coming, covering a wide area. Many times the amount of oil spilled, while about 17% of oil was recovered, that still left a tremendous amount out in the environment. 1,100 miles of shoreline oiled in a very different shoreline than you may be used to. 1,200 miles of seafloor were coated. There were four times the number of responders in the Deepwater Horizon as in the Valdez, again, given the scope and scale. Many, many times the amount of money came in for settlements from the disaster. And yet, if you start to look at the mortality, the damage estimate, what you see if you jump down to the bottom line with the marine mammals, the estimate for the Valdez was 22 killer whales were killed. In the Deepwater Horizon, there are 31 stocks of marine mammals. And the estimate was that each of those was damaged anywhere from 4 to about 100%. So tremendous damage to the cetaceans. In comparison, while you would expect for a much bigger, longer, less finite spill, a greater mortality, if you look at the official damage estimates, 250,000 seabirds from the Valdez compared to, for the official natural resources damage assessment estimate, between 56,000 and 102,000 birds killed total, all birds, including marsh birds, et cetera. That seems really low. So what's going on there? With what they call the NERDA estimate, what you can see is that there are a lot of categories that were effectively not estimated, and that was acknowledged in the official estimate and the description of what happened. It was a really difficult spill to get into. I'll show you pictures of marsh later that show that it's really difficult to get in to some areas in the Gulf. It can be challenging to assess. So they didn't really estimate mortality in any months except July and August. The spill started in April. oil flowed actively until the end of July. There was oil apparent and visible in the system easily on many of the islands and marshes 3 years later. There's still a lot of oil in the system. They did not look at repopulation of the offshore areas, so they assumed a bird population size in midsummer. They did not consider birds are continuously coming back into the system, moving through in migration, etc. They did not estimate marsh bird mortality. They did not estimate mortality of birds in the center of the breeding colonies on the islands. Where were the majority of birds during the oil spill in the summer in the Gulf? They were on those colonies on those islands. There are a lot of reasons for the way that was done, but it means that there's a lot that didn't happen. There were also some technical challenges with the disaster and the estimate. Because the disaster was so large, it took most of the personnel for federal agencies, state agencies, and frankly, everyone else who could lend a helping hand during the summer of the spill. Normally, for a NERDA estimate, any of the studies that are done to estimate, say, carcass drift are done during the period of the spill itself. Then you're estimating recovery rates of carcasses at the same time period that the activity is happening. They didn't do the carcass drift study until the summer of 2011. In that summer of 2011, the majority of the winds were onshore, pushing carcasses more quickly to shore and getting them away from deterioration and the jaws of predators. In the summer of the spill, the winds were majority offshore, pushing carcasses away. You have a very different estimate. In addition, a lot of the currents were onshore when the carcass drift study was done. During the spill, the Mississippi River and the diversions from it were opened up wide to push oil offshore as much as possible. That also pushed carcasses. So there's fortunately a couple of scientists, Haney et al., did a couple of papers. One was about the estimated mortality of near coastal birds, and one was for pelagic or seabirds during the spill. They used data from outside of the natural resources damage assessment that was still in a black box because of the legal proceedings, but they did really good science. I reviewed both of their papers and assessed that, in my estimation, they were very, very solid. And their estimate was that during the acute phase of the spill, only about 800,000 birds died. If you start to add the additional mortality and some of the lost reproduction, you're looking at easily 1 million birds. So the official estimate is very low. The likelihood is a tremendous impact. Again, looking at the marine mammals, there are some things that you can see here. BB is for Barataria Bay, and MRD is Mississippi River Delta. For the marine mammals, groups like the Ocean Conservancy really believe that the science was done well for the damage estimate. You can see certain facts there, about a 51% maximum reduction in the Barataria Bay bottlenose dolphin population. Barataria Bay was the most oiled bay during the spill. The Mississippi Sound came next. The Mississippi River Delta region was heavily impacted. So tremendous drop in the number of marine mammals. The estimate from NERDA was that without any active restoration, it would take between 24 and 80 years for that population to recover. There were also declines of smaller levels in a couple of endangered whales. The challenge there is that if you have an endangered species, you're already at low numbers. You lose more of them, you're at lower numbers. And then what they call stochastic events or unpredictable events, things like major storms, oil spills, or disease running through a population can actually cause those lower populations to become more endangered or to even blink out. So tremendous harm, along with significantly reduced health and reproductive success. There was a Gulf of Mexico oil spill and ecosystem science conference last week, and a lot of the science is updated from that conference. They have been doing ultrasounds on dolphins, looking at the perinates, the young that have not been born. They're seeing markers that the 2017 season for reproduction will also be very low in the most impacted populations. Average birth rate for those dolphins is about 64%, and right now they're at about 19% for the last breeding season for the birth rate. So tremendously impacted at a population level. Health consequences for birds were many. Birds can get oil on their feathers, which reduces buoyancy, it impairs their flight, it can cause behavioral changes, and it reduces their ability to thermoregulate. So in the Exxon Valdez, birds got oiled and they just died. It's very cold. The water's cold, the air is cold. In the Gulf, birds were able to live a lot longer, but you end up with sort of a double whammy. You may have a really hot day when the oil causes birds to effectively bake, and they have to really struggle to stay fit through that. And then if you get a solid, hard thunderstorm in the afternoon, they may get very cold. So they're balancing thermoregulation on both ends, and it's extremely physically challenging. Ingestion of oil in birds has been shown to cause many effects, including disruptions to the endocrine system. It reduces viability of reproductive systems and can cause growth defects in juveniles, as well as completely wreck their reproduction for life. They also tend to be sicker and to get adrenal impacts that can cause mortality later on from other stressors. Interestingly, some things that the Natural Resources Damage Assessment did really well, they did some unique studies. They were curious about what happens when birds are oiled somewhat. So each of these roseate spoonbills is not clean pink. They have some oil on them, but they're still in flight. They would survive for at least a while. So what happens? The spill occurred in April during spring migration. It went through the fall when fall migration was happening. So millions of birds passing through the Gulf, encountering at least light to moderate oiling, and then flying out of the system. So the NERDA scientists did some flight studies. They put some oil on some sandpipers, put them in a flight tunnel, and recorded their flight capacity relative to clean birds. Their flight was dramatically impaired, which affects their likely survival and their ability to make it to their breeding grounds and reproduce. They also used homing pigeons, and they tracked how they went from a release location back to their home roosts repeatedly, and then they lightly oiled the birds, very lightly, and they recorded that the birds' behavior changed. They took alternate flight routes. What that means is if you look at maps of migration, if significant proportions of populations that normally migrate through an area were lightly oiled, it could alter migration routes in ways that could then affect the population for quite a long time. It's possible with what happened in the spill that you would see population declines, consequences to food webs, which I'll explore in more depth, altered ecological processes, economic loss. Tourism and ecotourism are big industries in much of the U.S. And then, of course, through the migration impacts for people who enjoy birds throughout Central, South, and North America. So the food web consequences, one of the most important prey fish in the Gulf of Mexico is the menhaden. They call it the most important fish in the sea. It's a fish that it eats primary producers, so it will eat plankton and detritus. Very, very abundant fish. They're important for any fish that are predators, and then for any predatory birds and many other animals in the Gulf. They're also a very important fishery. Menhaden are made into fertilizer, animal feed, oil, and protein for other sources. The authors of the bird studies, the independent authors of the bird studies, wanted to know what happened to predatory birds because they wanted to understand what happened to the menhaden fishery. And what they found in the year or two after the oil spill was that from an average production of about 21 billion menhaden, the productivity of menhaden in the next year went up to 53 billion, much higher than the highest previous recorded, which was 34 billion. What they, this sounds like a good thing for a fishery, a lot more fish. What happened is that there were many, many more juveniles. They think that they ate a lot of the plankton and reduced the food supply dramatically, causing the young of year to be very small, about half the normal size, and to have about half of the oil production that they normally do. So they're small, weak, and low-value fish. So there are tremendous implications if what they, I think it was 53 or 535,000 seabirds were lost. This has an implication for a prey fish, which has an implication for the primary producers, which then spins all the way back up through the whole system. I was talking about how the ecosystem looks a lot different than you're used to on the Pacific Northwest. We have marshes that have been not fed well by the Mississippi River for years. They are subsiding or sinking, which is a natural process, but they're not being fed by spring floods because of damming of the soil, keeping it upstream, and levying of the rivers downstream, keeping the spring floods from happening. These marshes get very stressed and they start to erode and they effectively turn into this Swiss cheese, which provides a lot of edge, good habitat for birds, but it's not sustainable and it's eroding quickly. If you imagine oil washing into and through this ecosystem, it can get to all of those edges, and anywhere that it gets that it impacts heavily is much more susceptible to root damage and then further erosion. There was a really good study done, but it wasn't started until after the worst of the oil spill had happened. If you think about shorelines, they tend to be somewhat smooth curves. And when these authors, the scientists, got out to study the marsh, they categorized marsh in this big bay as heavy, moderate, or light oil. Everything was at least somewhat oiled. And what they noticed, to their lack of understanding, was that the moderately oiled marsh was what was eroding back. And they had faster marsh erosion rates for moderate or heavy oil. They couldn't quite figure that out. Certainly, heavily oiled marsh should erode faster. And they realized later, as they continued to study, after that wave of moderate marsh oil, eroding back, the next wave was heavily oiled sections would drop back. What happened then was it created a jagged shoreline, and the pieces that still stuck out were more impacted by wave and wind erosion, and they started to cut back. So effectively, they missed the first wave of marsh loss. From heavy oiled loss, they caught the next wave of moderate loss, and then it started the cycle again. So in a system that had already, in Louisiana alone, lost an area of marsh the size of Delaware, the oil spill really cut marshes back and it hastened the erosion rate. Obviously, for marsh birds and for birds that depend on the food that is produced by marshes, that is not a good outcome. Beaches and barrier islands are also really important habitat for these creatures. I'm going to kind of run through these pictures one by one. This is in the summer of 2010, a flight over a large island. This could be breeding habitat for birds, but with bulldozers and heavy equipment and boats surrounding it all the time, there was too much disturbance for birds, and it was very heavily oiled. If you go to the next summer, 2011, to deal with the oil, especially on mainland beaches where people had access or on nearshore islands, they were actually having to make the decision to get the toxins out to scrape up heavily oiled sand and dump it in baskets and haul it away. So in an eroding system, we were hauling beach away to protect people and animals from the oil. Where they could, they put up sand cleaning machines and they cleaned massive amounts of sand and put it back into the system. If you super deep clean and steam clean sand and you put it back, you may have beach, but you may lack food, which birds find very helpful. This is one of the bay areas that was really heavily eroded. There were sticks placed out after some of the worst of the oil was there, and they're studying how fast the marsh was getting eaten back. I was on that island 1, 2, and 3 years after the spill, and you could see oil sheen in the water. If you put a foot in the marsh, it would sink down and sheen would come up. You could smell the asphalt smell as soon as the weather warmed up. There's active oil in many of those areas. The oil is being consumed by primary consumers, fiddler crabs and some of the snails, periwinkles are eating oil, and then they in turn are being eaten by birds and other creatures. So that oil is just constantly then still moving through the food web. And this island is called Cat Island. During the height of the spill, it was one of the places that every media crew, every nonprofit, everybody went out to check on it. It was a vibrant breeding colony for about 20,000 birds. It was an eroding but decent-sized mangrove island. The oil and dispersant mix is extremely toxic to most of what encountered it. In lab studies, they would put oil on things, marsh grass, mangroves, critters. Oil is bad. They would put dispersant on marsh grass or mangroves. Dispersant is bad. It caused injury. If they put oil dispersant mix, guess what happened? The toxicity was much higher, the morbidity or the injury was higher, and the mortality or death was also higher. So the oil dispersant mix is actually the most deadly to most of what's in the system. They heavily dispersed oil to keep it off of these habitats, but in the process it made it more available to roots and it made it more, in some ways, more deadly. So what was once a vibrant breeding island, as the mangroves died, this very low elevation island lost what was holding it together, and it has completely eroded. It is now sub sea level. It's a shoal now. Again, in a place with losing habitats, losing more faster is not a great outcome. So it's very difficult to, if a big oil spill happens, it's very difficult to figure out. There's an official process for bird rescue and for other types of response. Who are you in the spill as an organization, and what is your role? And it's helpful to play on your strengths. We are Audubon, and we started immediately before the first oil reached land getting calls for interpretation of what this meant for birds. Who would go extinct? How bad was this going to be? We did a lot of advocacy and interpretation. We had more than 4,000 media hits. Major work for a lot of the major news networks, including CNN, multiple stories on NPR. We took media, local, regional, and national, out to help them understand not only the spill, but then the context in an eroding ecosystem. What more does this mean? We did several reports based on independent data that we collected. And we were able to help some partners who really wanted to go out and rescue all of the birds on the islands understand that the Fish and Wildlife Service decision to sit back and wait for birds to come off of islands before you rescued them was actually the better decision. I have seen many nests of pelicans with one clean baby and one oiled baby. And if you drive a boat in and you try to grab the oiled baby, what happens is that the clean baby jumps into oil. If you go on to these crowded colonies during a spill with oil all around, you create mayhem and you completely destroy nesting success. So the stand back and wait order was a really good one. It was really helpful for partners to understand that and for the media to know that this was not negligence and it was not trying to hide the problem. It was trying to save birds at a population level. We also did a lot of policy and planning and have continued to do that. Once the worst of the spill was over, Audubon put forth this report, Restoring the Gulf for Coastal Waterbirds. It outlines our three main goals, the initiatives that we think it will take to begin to bring birds back. And it's a good strategy. We stand by it 6-7 years later. We had suggested some sample projects, and many of those are done. A new project list could be valuable, but this isn't a document that many of the agency folks will still hold up in public meetings and say, we understand this is valuable, we're working to get a lot of this work done. There are also all of the policy issues. Mostly when there's a big spill, penalty money from the Clean Water Act goes into the general federal treasury. That money does not come back to the region. The polluters are supposed to clean up the damage and repair the system. The Clean Water Act penalty money goes to the federal government. We worked with legislators and Congress to help write legislation and to get our priorities into it. It's called the Restore Act. It is to restore the economy and the environment of the Gulf following the spill. And that act dedicates 80% of the Clean Water Act penalties, which is a significant amount of money, back to the Gulf to help with restoration. That was a big policy win. We have commented on every environmental impact statement. On the PDARP is it's a programmatic damage assessment and restoration program. If there is a process, we are going to comment. We've gone to hundreds of public meetings, trying to ensure that birds that were a priority in the media are a priority in the restoration. People also really, really wanted to help during the spill, and what was written into the oil response plan for BP was a group that often does field rescue was written in as the field rescue group. A group that does the bird cleaning was written in as the official responder, and BP said no volunteers. So we had 32,000 people that called us and wanted to help. We got more than 1,000 of those people actively involved in doing something hands-on in the spill. I foolishly told U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service that when they realized they had a gap they couldn't fill, they could call me. That happened at 3:45 the next morning. They called me. And I, at times, was literally on two cell phones talking to someone out in the field who had a bird that they couldn't get to a rescue and talking to our D.C. office to find a volunteer who could get to that bird and transport it 8 hours by car to get it over to the right place. So we helped a little bit with the wildlife transport. We got people to babysit birds, so they came in from out in the marsh or the Gulf. Sometimes the ground transport wasn't there yet, and so we had people that made sure birds stayed safe and in the shade and out of harm's way. There was a lot going on with trying to get Mississippi River Delta restoration in Louisiana really supported. We did a lot of letter writing campaigns, got thousands of comments to Congress to try to get a lot of this funding. We had people create noose mats to catch shorebirds, and then we handed those over to the rescue people to use. We collected data and started a program called the Audubon Coastal Bird Survey, which is now very prevalent throughout the Central Gulf. We did not have good, consistent abundance and density data for birds across the Gulf at the beginning of the spill, so we started to fill in gaps. We now have a regular source of counts for birds for spring and fall migration and winter, and we get with that dead birds. We don't have what you all have had with the really good dead bird surveys. And we got people helping in national wildlife refuges, again, counting birds and collecting data, and trying to help move us to where we could get into restoration work. We also did our own independent risk and damage assessment. Audubon scientists went out at various periods to assess what was going on, count oiled birds we could see from boats around islands. Some of that wasn't robust enough to do, to really add into the natural resources damage assessment, but we chose to stay outside of that process so we could be a voice for birds, which we couldn't be if we were in a confidential process. The value of doing that even sporadically was being at a conference where the BP contractors stood up at a paper and said, in our boat-based surveys, we only ever found 500 oiled birds. The damage was just not that bad, people. And I was able to stand up in the next talk and say, odd, from my field notebook on this date, I saw more than 5,000 oiled birds in one day from boats. I'm not sure what you guys were doing, but in a room full of scientists, being able to be a voice that contradicts the PR coming out from the polluters, it was really valuable to have some of that role. And then one of the things that Audubon's done really well, and it's part of our history, is directly protecting birds. In the direct spill zone, we were often kept out of places due to liability issues, and BP could make those calls. where there was less immediate damage, but there was a lot of protection work, putting booms down, people running up and down the beach in ATVs trying to frantically prevent what might be coming. We were able to work with state and federal agencies and with other folks to make sure that they recognized where bird colonies were, that they stayed out unless it was absolutely necessary that they be in. And we were thus able to protect nesting success in the more peripheral parts of the spill while birds were getting really harmed in the center of it. So the question then becomes, for a lot of groups of bird lovers, do you get involved in rescue and rehabilitation? We were not written into the plans. There was no role. And for one, I was fairly grateful for that. We wouldn't have had the trained staff and capacity. Some groups do want to do that, and Seattle Audubon is working on being in those official roles and then being able to get people trained and ready to do the response. It's very challenging work. You have to be expert. You can cause a lot more harm than good. There are also some difficulties. I'm more of a population level person. I want to make sure we restore populations, and a lot of birds that get oiled die in the process of transport or being cleaned. Many of the ones that are successfully cleaned and released lose a lot of their reproductive success. Some people say that we shouldn't do bird rescue in disasters like this. I disagree with that. We are humans. We have a level of distress and even culpability in a spill like this that I think to do the moral thing and to feel like we're doing the right thing, I think some people have to do the rescue. But when you have maybe a million birds killed and you have about 6,000 that come into the rescue or 8,000, it's clearly a negligible part that you can do. The rescue and rehab has gotten so much better. A lot more birds do survive it. But it's helping a lot of individuals, and I was glad we stayed focused at the broader level. It was more our skill set. You also really have to think in the competition and the chaos that come with a really big spill. Everybody wants a role. Everybody's frantic. A lot of people and groups are doing things that don't make sense. You want to think as a group about what your liability is and how much you're protecting your people. This was a brutal event that went for months. People did not sleep. People ended up with PTSD. People ended up injured. So it's something that you really want to think about. What do we do and what do we do well? How can we figure out what our strengths are and how we go forward? And then ideally, you don't want to get to the really big spill. So prevention and any work that you can do to get ahead of the game is better. Some things that didn't exist in the Gulf that are there now, there were not independent flights to look for oil spills in the Gulf. It's a big region, but a nonprofit decided to watchdog and hold companies more accountable, and they have paired up with flight groups and individual pilots who want an excuse to go fly their planes. And they do regular watchdog flights. They document spills. They report. It's all been self-reporting of spills in the Gulf until the Deepwater Horizon. I mean, there's some independent assessment from the feds, but this really puts completely objective eyes out there looking for sheen, reporting, and making sure that the agents, the oil companies themselves are not under-reporting the size. That data has been useful for people to really be able to push for more money for enforcement, for more money for watchdogging, and to really just help the companies understand that there are other eyes out there and it is better to be upfront in the beginning. It's really also important to partner with other organizations and to think about if you want to stop or prevent or reduce, who has the winning argument? How many bird people think that birds are the winning argument? Everybody. How many people that we're talking to think birds are the winning argument? There are a lot of allies and partners out there, and if you don't have relationships with government agencies, state and federal, they have a lot of economic risk. They should be thinking about what they can do for prevention. Fishers, the entire fishing communities are tremendously at risk of losing income, losing their culture and way of life. Native peoples, I think, face a lot more in some respects than most other people do. in many ways, they are more tied to the environment more closely. It is more the basis for their beliefs, their culture, their way of life. It may be something that a lot of us go to occasionally to visit. It is something that they live in and rely on much more strongly. And in the Pacific Northwest, my understanding is that they've gotten much better at advocating for maintenance of and respect for those legal rights. And that's a really, that's maybe often the winning argument. Environmentalists should all care, but industry faces increased regulation and big fines in some ways if they violate. They should be interested in this too. And something we don't talk about a lot generally is the lost use for recreation. The assessment for lost use of resources in the Gulf following the spill was $15 billion. That impacts everyone who might have gone to the Gulf in any period of time that was affected in the US. That gives you a huge constituency and a big audience. So talking a little bit more about communities, there are some things that are fairly consistent with communities. Often the people who live closest to the coast are those who have been the most displaced from the places that they've wanted to be for generations. And that may include native people in Louisiana and parts of the Gulf. It includes also immigrants and Cajuns and Creole people. They are the first to be hit with a major water-based storm. They're the first to lose. They often have the least access to resources. And that is true whether it's Native Americans or immigrants or others that get pushed to the fringes of where we all live. The other thing is that the poorest people who are the most dependent on natural resources to make a living, and they may be communities that live very sustainably, they're most likely to lose their food and their food security when something like this happens. They are then the most likely to get tapped to help with cleanup. It's money, it's a way to start to rebuild, but it puts them at tremendous risk. The posters in the first couple of years at the Gulf Oil Spill Conference talked a lot about the health implications for the cleanup workers. There were headaches, back pain and significant back problems, sleeplessness, incredible stress, PTSD, depression. I looked at a lot of those posters because I wanted to know how normal the things I was experiencing were and what they were connected to. Memory loss is also a big one, and a lot of it was actually connected to stress and sleeplessness and too long work hours rather than directly to the toxicity. But there are some really big health problems that have been plaguing some of our coastal communities since the spill. And when you add to that lost income, stress, depression, and PTSD for whole families, you start to build up the social ills, things like abuse, abandonment, and suicide. So you really want to think about which communities are at the most risk, and is there a way that you as a community can support them? Because undoubtedly, inevitably, someone has it worse than you, even if you really are distressed by what's going on. But there's also resilience. You know, we all know that ecosystems are resilient and people are tremendously resilient. So what are some of the factors that help? For communities, trust, social trust and trust in the community helps. Information, disaster management efforts by outsiders, access to resources, they are all protective. The ability to see a disaster as having transformative potential is tremendously helpful. So if you think again about Native American communities or immigrant communities, they may be very strong in some of those community resilience factors, social trust, community itself, belief in transformative capacity. But they may have language barriers and there may be less access to resources or information or to the disaster management functions. For individuals, people that are older, people with higher incomes, and people that are farther removed from a disaster are the most resilient. So again, this can help you think about and target where are the resources most needed. It may be that you do not do social justice work and you do not get involved in that way, but certainly there are probably individual people that may be more affected that you might be able to know and to reach out to. And in something like this, it's really important that anyone you touch, you think about what they're going through, because again, it can be pretty challenging. There is, of course, after a disaster, there is always hope. Everything is resilient. You know, months into the spill, when humans were really distressed, pelicans were flying around fighting over big sticks and bringing fish to babies and generally having a ball. Some of them were also covered in oil. It's really important to look at what you can do and restore and how you can keep hope in a big scary situation. This really spoke to Audubon's mission. This is America's first game warden who was hired by Audubon to work on America's first national wildlife refuge. This goes to the core of what we've done for over 100 years and what we've done well. And it really focused attention on beach nesting birds, which are some of the fastest declining species in the Gulf. So in our restoration plan that I showed, we talked about three major goals or phases of restoration that should happen to bring birds back to their full potential. One is bird beneficial projects and monitoring of those. And so that's on the ground restoration. Restore an island, build an island, create a marsh, renew a marsh. Gulf bird research and planning. I mentioned the lack of data that we had that were consistent and helped us understand populations. We are still lacking a lot of that. We do not have a plan that says we need X population of black skimmers and Y population of Wilson's plovers, and here's how we get there. I've been trying to get that funded for a really long time, and that is still a big goal. And then we would like a sanctuary system, a system of places on the ground that birds get actively protected from threats, that somebody is looking at the threats, figuring out the solutions, and playing whack-a-mole with them. There are always going to be threats. How can we stomp them out, let birds have a good breeding season, let them forage in peace, and let them start to recover? And so you have to know what your places on the ground are. We have important bird areas across the Gulf. Some are smaller and some are larger, but they're the places that we know that if we protect these sites, we will be protecting the majority of the key populations. The pink dots are stewardship sites. Those are those places that we go to, we assess threats, we try to stomp out threats. They're the whack-a-mole sites. And then the stars are for project locations. This may be where we restore or create or otherwise improve habitats and create projects that will help start to bring back more land for birds to be on. So we also feel like we need to develop a business plan. There are groups that have been funding business plan development for other species and other groups of birds. We've been lobbying for this and kind of getting pushback that it's too soon or too late, but we really feel like this would get federal and state and nonprofit partners all on the same page with strategies and priorities. And then we need to think about the habitats. So what if all we do are build islands with mangroves? Well, we'll have really good brown pelican populations, but Wilson's plovers and black skimmers may be a little unhappy. We need to know where across a landscape, how much of what type, how quickly do we build it, how quickly will it erode, how large should it be to prevent some of those problems. And then once we start to figure out where and what we need, we can start to do restoration and create habitat. This picture is of Alafaya Banks, a coastal sanctuary in Florida that supports and protects 18 species of colonial water birds. It's one of their really important sites they'd been working on prior to the oil spill. They were building these breakwaters, which you see surrounding the island. And what happens with the breakwaters is that waves come in and sometimes harder wake from boats. It crashes into the breakwaters, drops behind, and then it recedes more slowly because of the stones. And that allows the sand to build up. They're actually growing the island behind these breakwaters. So they were able to complete, I think, this entire project with some of the oil spill funding, thereby more securing the fate of this island and the birds it supports. And then the stewardship. That looks different in different places, but there are some common elements. Birds nest on the sand. A study in North Carolina showed that many residents of coastal counties had no idea that birds will nest on the ground. There's just a lack of knowledge. So we put up posts and simple ropes that won't really keep someone out if they want to get in, but it's called symbolic fencing. It lets them know there's something there to be protected. We put signs up, and then we put volunteer stewards with spotting scopes there to show people cute baby birds so that they'll care and recognize that we're not trying to take away the beach, but we would like people to share the beach. Keep dogs on a leash, don't run ATVs through a colony. And part of that is doing outreach and education. So the more people that know birds nest on the ground and that care, the better. So we go into schools. And the other part of this is the more that communities are on board and feel that it's their colony, it's their birds, the better. So we get kids to make signs. We teach them about the birds. They make signs. They may do marker or crayon drawings. We get them made into actual signs, and we put those up. If you live in the feisty, private property-oriented Gulf South, what you may find when you put up a U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service sign is that you end up with buckshot through it pretty quickly. But if your grandchildren or your cousin or your friend's kids put up a sign that says, "Don't be a pest, protect my nest," those pretty well stay and get left alone. You know, it's much more of a community effort, and there's a lot more buy-in and a lot more than the community members will often become your stewards, which is really valuable. We also collected data, some citizen science data that I mentioned. This was actually collected by staff. What you can see in this graph is a number of nesting pairs and then a timeline. The points are the times that data was collected, so we don't have great Wilson's plover data except one point in 2005 when there were very few nesting pairs on these two islands that are very near shore. But what you start to see when we start Audubon protection is the first year you get a couple more pair, and then you start to get these really big increases. People start to be aware, the disturbance is much less, the habitat's better protected, and it's starting to become more favorable. And the birds start to realize this is a good site. And the same thing then on Elmer's Island, once we started the protection, then suddenly the birds start to come in. So if you build it and you keep people from stomping on it too much, they will come. This is big success. And then planning and implementing monitoring. I've talked to the dearth of data. Several of us got together, federal, state, and nonprofit scientists and some academics, and thought, we need to monitor all the birds in the Gulf of Mexico, and we'll figure out how to do that today. We are very optimistic people. At the end of the day, as an exercise, we all wanted to do everything and monitor everything and count everything, because counting birds is really fun. And it was clear that we had no priorities, and so I asked us to make up a dream budget, and it was $21 billion for year one. And we decided that maybe we should go back and figure out a process to create some priorities. So we know now very clearly that we want to assess status. We want to know how the bird populations are doing, general levels, increase, decrease, stable enough. We want to know what the most important restoration or management actions are, and if we do not know enough about their effect on birds of particular groups, we need to start to get there. So fill information gaps. And then the same thing with what we call ecological processes. If we get a lot of sea level rise, who are going to be the winners and losers? Major hurricanes start to increase in intensity or frequency, what are the outcomes? So we need to understand these. We are getting a lot closer to having a tool that we can use to judge proposals that come in for monitoring that a funder could use, but also to guide ourselves. Our group put in several proposals that we should hear about next month for doing some of the science based on the priorities we've already developed. And then the last part, really, it kind of goes back to the stewardship and protection, is implement adaptive management. So we've got a lot of birds. We know that they need help. The whack-a-mole thing. You go out, you put up signs and ropes, and you suddenly create lots of baby birds because you've got people not running across nests. Baby birds equal coyote snacks. So if you start to see a lot of coyote predation, you know that you need to start to deal with predator problems. So adaptive management is just, what is the new thing that we see? How do we adapt and manage differently? And that could be putting up decoys. The flat birds that look somewhat two-dimensional are decoys. And if you put them up, terns will sometimes move from sites that are not as ideal into places that are better for them to nest. The other thing is social marketing. So some of these campaigns may look familiar to you, but you may not know who started them. Who started Don't Mess with Texas? A social marketing campaign is a campaign in which you identify a problem, identify problematic behavior, decide what the group is or the audience that is perpetrating the behavior, so littering in Texas. What is the group? It turned out to be young, kind of tough males, 20-ish year olds, 20 to 30 year old males. So you identify barriers to change. Why don't young males want to stop throwing trash? Well, because it's not cool to pick up after yourself. So how can you then eliminate the barriers to change? So they found a bunch of Harley dudes who were well known, and they started doing commercials with Harley dudes saying, don't mess with Texas. It appeals to Texas pride. It appeals to young, tough guys. It was their heroes, and they started to really develop an ethic. So we need a social marketing campaign. This is an example of a local one developed with Audubon, North Carolina, the Be a Good Egg campaign. Ideally, this is a really big thing. It costs millions of dollars. It is not branded Audubon. It is that people start to realize birds do this, this behavior is a problem, here is what we do in response. And you change an ethic by getting people to believe that it is the cool thing to do the right thing. Click it or ticket is a different version, but if people believe that they are likely to be ticketed for no seatbelt, they are more likely to buckle up. And then the last thing Audubon is really working on is, I can't do this talk for everybody. I cannot get a politician to sit still this long. You guys are great. How do we communicate results? Can we do things with snapshot pictures that really allow us to tell a funder or a decision maker or a landowner, here's how we've helped birds in most of the Gulf. Here's how there's a gap in your town. Here's what you can do. So scorecards or other visuals that allow people to see history, current status, what it needs for success. So we're working on these across the Gulf and actually across all of our coasts. There's a lot more that could be done. We all need to work more on climate resiliency. We could work across hemispheres. Some of these birds can't be protected well enough when they're in the US. They need work in other parts of their life cycle. How do we restore pelagic birds? They're out over the water all the time. We can't do beach-based stewardship. What comes for them? And then forage fish. The Pacific Flyway team with National Audubon is really working on trying to protect forage fish. Doesn't matter how well you let birds breed, if they don't have things to feed their babies, you still have a problem. So again, you have this craziness, and then you really want to be able to move forward and do what's right. A lot of groups come into a place after a big spill. There's a lot of opportunism, a lot of money, clearly, that multi-billions of dollars comes into the Gulf. And you can see a little bit of a breakdown, and I'll kind of spin through this. To clean up natural resources damage, there's more than $8 billion that's coming in total. We have managed to get, for projects we believe in, $133 million as of last year had come in for those projects. So not all to Audubon, clearly, but to things that we think are really beneficial to birds. The problem with that really low number for bird damage is that it could lead to a really low number for bird restoration. Instead, the $403 million is actually quite a good chunk for restoration. That's just for bird projects. Every marsh project should also help birds. Every island restoration should also help birds. Every oyster reef should also help birds. So while we felt like the estimate was low, it did not have an impact in the ultimate outcome we desire, which is that there's plenty of money for restoration. The criminal penalty monies, $2.54 billion, went to National Fish and Wildlife Foundation. That money's been being dispersed. We have used it to build a lot of these coastal stewardship programs so that we're on the ground doing a lot of work. And then restore the oil, the Clean Water Act penalties, $4.4 billion, 80% of that goes to the Gulf to be dispersed over about 15 years. A key thing with this, and this is sort of how it gets back to the Pacific, if you get some legislation like this, it's important to recognize that everybody doesn't believe that environmental restoration is the best way to go. Some of this money is dedicated to the states to do with as they choose. A lot of that will be to restore economic damage. That was significant, and that is fair. But it's possible that you will rebuild an island, and then somebody will decide at the state level to build a bridge to the island, and suddenly you've got this place that birds could nest, but you've got a lot more people on it. So there's a balancing act, and it will be a continuous effort for us, for the history of this whole spill, to stay on top of things, to argue where there seems to be a really bad project, but mostly to just try to help protect birds depending on what's coming at them. So these are Gulf program goals, but we're thinking big. We'd like to ensure a consistent funding stream of about $10 million for the Gulf for birds for Audubon protection over 20 years. $10 million a year for 20 years. We'd like the projects we believe in to be getting about $1 billion. We'd like to grow our number of sites and staff and volunteers. And we'd like ultimately for all of the coasts in the US for our coastal initiative to be protecting at least 500 sites, having strategic land holdings that benefit birds, being the go-to group that provides data on birds for federal and state and other agencies. And we rely on our great history, our advocacy and policy, and expanding international partnerships. I lived through this and still live through this spill every single day. It has completely altered my life in ways that are both positive and negative. In Chinese, the word for disaster is identical to the word for opportunity. And I think that that's a really important thing. This is not a fun or pleasant talk to hear. It's a difficult talk to give. There's a lot of what brings you down in it, a lot of damage. But there's a lot of potential for restoration. There are people who quit their jobs after too much oil spill. I worked personally 225 hours in the first 2 weeks of the spill. And a tremendous amount after that. It alters people's lives completely. You have to think about what you can take on. It's better to take on prevention than it is to have the ultimate spill. But if you have it, it's good to know how much you're willing to put in. I do think that it's hard sometimes for environmentalists to stay hopeful. Things seem very overwhelming. And something that I've latched onto that I tell myself a lot, and I find it really, really helpful, I saw the Dalai Lama speak in New Orleans a couple years into this disaster, and someone asked him, you know, he's lost his homeland and so many people in the world rely on him, and he's trying to deal with the biggest problems, not one of them, all of them. And, you know, his entire country relies on him to be their standard bearer, and somebody asked him, what do you worry about? And he giggled, and he said, I do not worry. If there is a problem and I can do something about it, I do that, and I do not have to worry. If there is a problem I can do nothing about, then I can do nothing about it, and I don't have to worry. And then he giggled, like the Pillsbury Doughboy. I think it's really important for all of us to remember that each single person may put everything they can into it, but you have to pull yourself back and you have to renew yourself to be able to continue to do what's important. Family's important. Your life is important. Connecting to healthy, clean nature is important. And I hope that you will all, you know, continue to fight what you're fighting and continue to do good work professionally and personally and as volunteers, but also to remember that everybody else in this room and many, many people in the Gulf and people all over the world are still supporting you and fighting that good fight with you. It is not on you alone. You are able to step back and you're able to take care of yourself and be ready for whatever comes next. And I thank you for your attention. I think this is really true, and I also draw hope from the birds which come back and they breed and they look extremely cute doing so when they're skimmers. If you take care of birds, you will take care of most of the problems in the world. And I'm happy to take questions. I will repeat the questions and try to answer those that I am able to. Thank you so much. Yes. So the question was, in the advocacy and interpretive work, was the focus more on a, sort of a species level or flagships, and how much of it was more on a habitat level? And the answer is it was really both and. It was not either or. It depended a lot on what the interviews were and the questions were, the direction for the answers. But broadly, Audubon Louisiana does work on bird species, but also has a tremendous role in what we call the Mississippi River Delta Restoration Campaign, which is really focused on releasing water and sediment from the major rivers back into the marshes to restore them. So we had some voices that were speaking predominantly to the damage of habitats and the need for restoration of those. We had voices that were predominantly speaking to the impacts on birds at an individual or population level. And with that 4,000 media hits, we flooded the media with messages. So definitely both. And we talked about birds at the individual suffering level, and we talked about birds at the population level. So again, it depended on the outlet and the need. Yes, ma'am. Good question. The question was, do you see a change already in the interest or the focus in what you're doing with the new administration? Not immediately yet. I was at the Gulf Oil Spill Conference last week. I was able to talk to some partners who were fairly high up in federal agencies. There is some nervousness, for sure. The recognition is that what we are doing right now is not immigration, and it's not healthcare, so it's flying a little bit under the radar in the first couple weeks. But there is a significant amount of money earmarked for and dedicated to the Gulf, and there is certainly a concern that there will be attempts to redirect some of that. And there are certainly people who are, in their levels of state and federal government, concerned that it will be very hard to stay focused on the work that has been prioritized. Yes, sir.
Two questions.
Good questions. You may have to repeat the second one. So the first question was BP as an individual industry on a scale of 1 to 10, what score would I give them for their efforts to clean this up? So I'm not going to give them a total score, but describe a little bit about the pluses and minuses. Usually the government has to complete the damage assessment before any money starts to come in to repair the damage. This was so huge, even BP had to acknowledge that there was going to be a big damage assessment and they were going to get hit in the wallet. And to show good faith and to be a better partner and to, you know, try to look better, frankly, they ponied up what they called an early NERDA payment of $1 billion right off the bat. They said, $1 billion, we will start to put that out. You can start to clean up the damage right away. There's a little bit of a plus minus to that. If they start to clean up damage, they do a restoration project in a place that the damage hasn't been fully assessed yet. Once it's cleaned up, you can't count it against them. So it's a tough balancing act, but certainly that upfront payment helped to start to restore things immediately. Another big plus for what BP did, they made a decision early on that they had created an unprecedented mess. And it was also, again, disaster opportunity, an unprecedented opportunity to make progress forward in understanding oil and movement of it and dispersants and spills and critters. They ponied up $500 million to an independent science board to fund research. This conference I've referred to is now known as the Gulf of Mexico Oil Spill and Ecosystem Science Conference. From the work that started being funded 5 or 6 years ago, almost 7 years ago, they've produced, scientists independent of BP have produced over 900 papers. There is tremendous research going on by consortia. There's a huge push to get that research out into the hands of managers and decision makers and policy makers. So it's not just doing the science, it's making sure it's accessible. A tremendous amount of knowledge gained about everything from, they've studied new dispersants and tried to create new dispersants that would be less toxic. So tremendous research. Interestingly, the board has not been very interested in higher level vertebrates. So One bird project was funded of 900 papers. One has been published that's really about birds. That's it. So birds were the poster child, and they, from the science community, have gotten almost zilch. And the scientists who wanted to study them couldn't get funding from that board. So that's been a big downside. That's not on BP's shoulders. At the same time, I mean, I really believe that BP tried to minimize and obfuscate and deny as much as they possibly could. Their bottom line is their shareholders, and it was to their benefit for there to be a low damage assessment. A lot of studies that should have gotten started earlier sat on desks, and probably at both levels, BP and government. You cannot create this big a spill and have people able to respond appropriately. So I think a lot happened that was not ideal. And I don't know what score to give BP, but they would prefer to look better, and I think there was a lot of disservice done to the ecosystem and the humans involved and the critters involved in that process. The second part of your question was? Okay, right. So the second question is, for the industry as a whole, have we learned enough to mitigate or prevent this? The industry as a whole gathered together during that first summer and said, we recognize that we have advanced the science of deep water drilling over the last four decades in unprecedented ways, but we have not advanced the science of response appropriately. And so a consortium came together, and I was part of a panel discussion early on where these industries started to come together and try to work on response to improve capabilities, to improve readiness. I have not kept up with that fully. I think that there has been significant progress made. But it's obviously more to their benefit to be able to go further and drill deeper and faster. I don't think we will ever really have industry be responsible enough to be prepared for what might happen at the next stage. I hope they're better prepared than they were, because we were at the same level of response for the Gulf Deepwater Horizon as for the Ixtoc spill, which was decades earlier. So the science has advanced, but we'll see. So the question was that I've talked a lot about the penalty money and the punitive money, but that also a lot about the response, that the response cost a tremendous amount. And the question is, wouldn't it be better to make sure that the penalties are high enough and scary enough that it is better for the companies to be proactive about prevention instead of focusing on response and being willing to pay the penalty? So can we make it big enough that they are unwilling to have a spill? The natural resources damage assessment process, from the outside view in that I had of it, is extremely frustrating and somewhat opaque. We stayed out of it on purpose so we could be a voice for birds. But there's a tremendous amount of what happens that goes from what is the actual physical damage, which you have to prove in court to a level of certainty that is very hard to get in science. And you have to get agreement either in a settlement or you have to get a judge to agree on the final damage in a way that effectively, whatever the background level of damage is in a system that's already going on, can't be held against the polluter. If you cannot show a mechanism and a pathway from oil to the damaged resource, you cannot claim that that was damaged. There's a tremendously high level of legal requirement on this. And so what happens is scientists go out and do a lot of work, and then lawyers are the ones all in the room arguing. And your NERDA outcome, that money penalty, it is a legal compromise, mostly. You know, BP doesn't want to get the worst fine they could. The feds want to get as much, and states want to get as much as they can to restore. But this is fought in the courts. This was a tremendously high monetary cost for all of the companies involved. There were other companies involved. They also had costs. But this is a tremendously high punishment. $33 billion? That is 15 times more, at least, than the Exxon Valdez. Is this going to be a deterrent to other companies? One would hope. But should we have higher penalties for releases, releases from boats? Little releases from smaller companies? Should we have higher penalties for a 5-gallon release that people are just start to get careless about? That becomes a really big legal question, and yes, that's the ideal. The ideal is that it makes way more sense for them to prevent than to clean up. But I don't know quite how we get there as a society legally. It's a great question. The question was, with the proliferation of drones and the fact that a lot of groups are trying to do more community outreach and get younger people involved in environmental work, have we seen a proliferation of use of drones to do some of this oil spill assessment instead of expensive airplanes? I am not aware of that being done much, and I'm not as familiar with the technology, how far drones can go from operators. But I suspect that that right now is the limiting factor. They can fly and they can take pictures and videos, but I don't know that they can get in the Gulf far enough from anything to be a valuable resource in terms of taking the required pictures. I think that might be the limitation at this stage. It's certainly a good idea, though. Right. So the adjunct question is, what is the level of protection that Louisiana, how hard are they willing to go on these companies and how protective of the environment? There's a big push-pull in Louisiana. A tremendous amount of the jobs and the economy is based on the oil and gas industry. And not enough of that has gone into environmental protection just by way of taxes or other funding streams. I don't know if the state has officially gotten more protective or harder on companies in the intervening years, but what I know, and this spoke volumes to me, one of the parish presidents, their counties are called parishes, came up to me at that panel that was with the industry. And she said, people from outside of the state don't understand. We are now neck deep drowning in oil and begging for more. They are so dependent on oil and gas industry to keep the state afloat that they are in a very tough position to try to limit. There is no desire to limit oil and gas drilling, mostly because it's so much of the economy. Thank you.
Thank you.